Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh teman-teman semuanya. Selamat datang di Jembatan Dakwah, dan kali ini ada sebuah video dari Muhammad Ali lagi ya teman-teman. Dan di sini ada seseorang yang ragu akan keimanannya. Kemudian ia bertanya dengan Muhammad Ali dan mendapatkan jawaban yang memuaskan. Akan tetapi sayang sekali dia belum ingin masuk Islam. Kira-kira kenapa? Simak video ini hingga akhir agar kalian tidak salah paham. Selamat menonton dan semoga bermanfaat. Mari kita mulai.
Yes. The whole concept of the monotheism and stuff, I've accepted that a long time ago because I was raised in a Christian household.
Okay.
But like the teachings or the history of Christianity didn't really make sense to me.
Okay. Okay.
So then one of my friends who's Muslim now, he's like lent me his Quran and he was just like telling me stuff.
Okay. Okay.
And a lot of it made a lot of sense, especially when they bring Jesus into it. Because before then, I didn't know that Muslims
believe in Jesus.
Had a connection with Jesus.
Yes, yes. But a lot of people think you're Antichrist or something like that.
No. I don't think
not you, but other people, they do that. Yes.
But
yes.
Like, I didn't know that he was like part of the history of Islam.
Okay.
But he's a prophet.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Just like all the other prophets and messengers. Yes.
So when I heard that, and then I was like reading the story, and like just the kind of things that like Jesus would do, like. There was the passage where like it says like he falls to his knees and prays, and it's like that made a lot of sense to me. The fact that
actually he fell on his face, so it's even more because you've got Catholics falling on their knees in the church, but that's not how he prayed.
Exactly,
he fell on his face, and only Muslims pray like this, you know?
Yeah,
yes.
Like Christians, they pray with like their hands.
Exactly. Yes.
Yes. So all of that kind of stuff, it made so much sense to me, and then I can read it more. Come to like
realization.
Yes.
This is the truth. Yes. Okay, so you're there. So what's stopping you from being Muslim? That's what I'm asking you.
I don't know, cause like I think it's just a thing with like my kind of personality.
Okay.
Where like I like to be completely prepared.
But you have to have a criteria or an understanding of what you mean by completely prepared.
Like,
what is that to you? What is that to you?
Like, obviously, like there's no person that knows everything. I know that. Like,
we're learning until we die. It's never going to stop, basically.
It's always in the secret knowledge. But like, I feel like I need a better foundation in like knowing.
Wouldn't it make sense to say that the criteria that Islam itself puts as enough should be enough for you as well? Now, what you think is enough, but what Islam determines enough should be enough. Wouldn't you agree? Because look, if I'm going to accept Islam, then what Islam says is enough for me to be a Muslim should be enough for me as well. Do you get what I'm trying to say?
Yeah,
so if the religion itself says, okay, this criteria is enough for you to be Muslim, you shouldn't be saying, no, I got a different criteria, but you want to accept this religion, you know?
Yeah.
So you should go with the criteria of the religion itself. Wouldn't you agree?
That makes sense.
Yes. So Islam is a very basic thing. Now, as long as you believe there's one creator worthy of worship, it's not a man, it's not a woman, it's independent, uniquely one, does not give birth, nor is born, does not have parents or grandparents or children, we're the creation of God, and there's nothing like unto Allah. Whatever you visualize in your mind, you cannot visualize the creator, the maker. If you believe that, do you believe in the prophets of God, and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon all of them, their messengers, sent by God to connect people back to the Lord, the maker, the creator, then according to the Islamic teaching, and you believe in the six things I'm going to say, you believe in Allah, which you already mentioned, prophets, which you already mentioned, you believe in the day of judgment, you believe in destiny, that God determines things, yes, and you believe in angels, right? You know, right? The six articles of faith, and you believe in the angels of God. If you believe in these things, then according to Islam, you are not just ready, you're okay, you don't need anything else. You've got the minimum criteria of being a Muslim. You understand what I'm trying to say? So if anyone believes in that, in essence, he believes as a Muslim believes. So if there's a Muslim walking in the street, what's the difference between you and him in belief?
is.
Yeah, that's it. You get the point. That's why this is. That's why Islam says, okay, now you're ready now to take the step and become actual Muslim, because you believe as a Muslim believes. In order for you to be a full Muslim, you need to testify Shahada, which I'm sure you already heard about because you already done your research, right? So the Shahada, which is a testimony of faith, and then the actions as well, which is learning how to pray step by step and all of that. Once you've done that, then now you're fully a Muslim. But you need to keep something in mind. It's like Islam is not a game, it's the truth. Which means if I don't accept it and I die, I go to hellfire. Even if you believe what you believe, because you did not take the step of accepting it truly and testifying it in front of your maker and your creator. You get what I'm trying to say? So if you know this is the truth, then you don't say, okay, I've got my own criteria, my personality. You say, okay, what does the religion say I need to do? You get what I'm trying to say?
I'm not trying to say that I have my own criteria.
No, I'm not saying you do. Maybe I said that in a way that I don't mean it in a negative way, right? I mean, generally, anyone should not have any other criteria other than what the religion itself says, if you do accept it to be truly from God. You get what I'm trying to say? Make sense?
Makes sense.
So you should be Muslim now. Let's do it. I think you're there. Don't overthink it, right? If it makes sense, believe in the tenets, because what I'm going to say to you to say is what you already said that you believe in. That there is one creator worthy of worship and Prophet Muhammad's messenger and servant. This is what you're going to say, right? This is how a person becomes Muslim. So you already believe that. So what you're going to repeat after me is what you already believe in your heart.
My thing is like, to me to do it now, I feel like, because I don't know, like, it's a proper practice.
Yes.
I will already, like, just be in sin from the minute I...
No, but that will happen either way. It doesn't matter how many years you study. You would not know everything which is permissible and impermissible. Muslims, they've been Muslims all their life, 60, 70 years, and they come asking questions. They come and they ask me, okay, is this thing permissible to do or not permissible to do? No one knows everything. Point is that when you become Muslim, is the journey now of the practical journey is always going to make you really remember what is right and wrong. Until you get into practicality, you're not going to remember. Because if you just keep it at the theoretical knowledge and you never practice in your life, you will always forget. You will learn today, okay, X is wrong. Tomorrow, after two weeks, you're going to forget that you learned that X is wrong. But when you practice it, okay, you abstain from eating certain meats because you learned it's impermissible. Practice in your life, you'll never forget that you don't eat this because it's impermissible. And Allah, He does not hold you accountable for that which you do not know. So when you say sin in Islam, it's not a sin. It's a sin if you intentionally know, learn that this is a sin first, and then you do it. If you do not know, you're ignorant, or you're still in the beginning of your learning journey, because we're all born ignorant. Allah says, أخرجكم من بطون أمهاتكم. He's the one who brought you from the bellies of your mothers. لا تعلمون شيئا. You do not know anything. Yeah. وجعل لكم السمع والأبصار والأفئدة. He's given you the hearing, the eyesight, and the mind and the heart to learn. So Allah brought you as an ignorant person. All of us are ignorant when we come out, right? Then we this journey of life of a learning journey on a day-to-day basis. I learn every day. Every day I figure out more things or specific details of what is permissible and impermissible. You get what I'm trying to say? So if you think that you're gonna do something wrong when you do not know, it's not a sin in Islam, because you're still in the beginning of your journey. And that's the whole point of us connecting you with someone. So once you're connected to that person, then he teaches you more of what is right and what is wrong. Because you might be researching something which is wrong, you might be researching from the wrong source, and you think this is wrong when it's not wrong, or you think it's okay when it's not okay. Do you get what I'm trying to say? So we all need guidance. So when you become Muslim, then you're able to be connected with someone who takes you on a step-by-step journey of teaching you what you need to do. Make sense? Okay. I want you to do it because you're ready, right? It's not for me. It's you do it because you do it for yourself. All I'm doing is I'm providing you with the guidance from a rational perspective, right? Is I telling you, look, if these are the problems, they're not problems. That's what I'm doing, right?
Fair enough. Yeah. Yeah. It makes sense. There's that, and there's also like, I don't know, the, obviously. obviously, like I said, I came from a
family. You want to talk about the family?
Yeah.
You know how I know you're going to talk about the family? Because Satan brings the same point for everyone, right? Everyone who wants to become Muslim is always the same thing, right? They're always worried about their surroundings, how people, their acquaintances, how they're going to look at them, or their direct family members, how they're going to perceive this idea. They all ask this question, right? And I can give you videos on my channel to watch, right? See, people, before they become Muslim, they always come with the same question. Why? Allah says in the Quran, do not follow the footsteps of Satan. Satan has footsteps, certain plan or certain agenda that he does with everyone. It's not he does something new with this person. No. It's always the same thing. He always attacks them from the idea that you're sinning, you're committing sins and this and that until you become perfect first and then become Muslim. Always this idea Satan comes with. And this idea of the family members, what they're going to do, whether people are going to think about you. And then the desires. That some people, okay, I don't want to leave this. I don't want to leave that. And I want to continue doing this, right? These are the main things Satan always comes with to the people to try to confuse them. Point is this. Allah, on the Day of Judgment, you will run away from your family members. I will run away from my family members, from my daughter, from my husband. When you see hellfire, you're going to forget everyone except yourself. You know what I'm trying to say? Even the prophets and messengers of God, they will say myself. People will come to them, they will say, go to God and intercede on our behalf. They will say myself. So they will say, one of them will say, I made this specific, let's call it mistake, or this thing which I don't think is right, so I cannot go in front of Allah, is myself. You go to another prophet, and then you go to another prophet, and then you go to, you know what I'm trying to say? Because look, on the Day of Judgment, Allah says, يَوْمَ يَفِرُ الْمَرُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ, when the person runs away from his brother, وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ, his mother and his father, right? وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ, his wife and his children, لِكُلِّ مْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنٌ يُغْنِيهِ, for each of them, he's got something in his mind that is sufficient for him to worry about anyone else. He's got himself. Am I going to end up in eternal hellfire or not? So the first thing I'm going to say is this, is your family is not going to support you on the Day of Judgment. My family is not going to support me on the Day of Judgment, right? Second thing I'm going to say is, this is a choice you make for yourself. Once you become Muslim, you've got no obligation to say anything to your family. Right? You don't need, Islam doesn't say become Muslim and go say to your family I become Muslim. There's no need for you to do that. You accept Islam, you learn it step by step. When you feel ready, you do it. Some people do it after 5 years. Literally, they say to the mother and father, I became Muslim after 5 years of them accepting Islam. Right? So it's all something that you do when you feel you're ready to do. And Islam teaches you have to be good to your parents. Yeah? وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Allah have ordained or decreed that you worship none other except Him, which is the most important thing in Islam. And then He linked that وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا, to be good to your parents. He linked it with the most important command, right? إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا. When they become old, فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ. Allah says, don't even say uff. You know when they do something, you get upset, you say, right? Allah says, even that, don't say it to your parents, right? So it's not, don't say no, don't even say off, right? وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا, and do not rebuke them or be mean towards them, right? وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا, and say to them a beautiful speech. وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ, and then lower your wing of humility to them, right? وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا, and say, oh Allah, my Lord, forgive them as they raised me when I was young, I had nothing, and they took care of me, they raised me, oh Allah, forgive them, I have mercy on them because they did that. Okay? And then Allah says, if your parents are not Muslim, right? Allah says, وَإِنْ جَاهَدَكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِي شَيْئًا, if they try to make you do something which is wrong, a sin or leave Islam or do something, فَلَا تُطَعُهُمَا, and do not obey them in that thing, which is disobedience to God. وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُفًا, and be their companion in this life as a favor for what they've done for you. Do you get the point? So Allah says clearly in the Quran that you still have to be their companion in their life, even if they're not Muslims. Even if they try, not they're not Muslim only, they're trying to make you do wrong. They say, okay, come back to Christianity or leave this evil. They're trying to do everything that, like that. Allah says you still have to be good to them. You have to be their companion, but don't obey them in that which goes against me. Right? So your family, my advice is this, accept Islam, be solidified in your position first, your faith increases, and then when you feel you're ready, share it with other people. Because always when people share it in the beginning, you get negative reviews. Because people either have a wrong idea about Islam, because of the media, as I'm sure you already know, right? Or they just hear something from their friends. They've got this very negative view of Islam. And then when they hear from you Islam, straight away they link it to something which is bad, say to you, they already have a negative reaction towards it, right? That's why always in the beginning, you should keep it to yourself, till you know, okay, now I'm ready, and then you can share it with them. Because that time when you share it with them, anything they will come with, you already research and you know, okay, that's not true because I've already done this and this and that. I've already been Muslim for this time, you can say to them, right? And you can see the impact on my life. And what happens is Islam changes your behavior so much, is that always the parents, they notice something. The friends, they notice, okay, something wrong about this person. He's behaving differently, right? And then sometimes they start inquiring. And then people in the fear, they say to their parents that they're ready, right? So this is what I'll advise you to do when it comes to the family idea. Okay? Because family will always be there. Until you die, family is going to be there. Okay? So you have to make the choices at one point. The family is always going to be there.
Yeah, that's true. Fair enough. Oh, yeah, that makes sense.
Okay, you ready to do it? As I said, I'll leave it for you. Okay, you think so? So let's do it. It's very simple. Let's start with the English, then we'll say the Arabic, okay? You say, I testify. There's nothing worthy of worship except Allah. And I testify that Prophet Muhammad is his messenger and servant. And I testify that Jesus is his messenger and servant. We say the same thing in Arabic now, okay? Ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah. Wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasul Allah. That's it. Let me give you a hug, man. MashaAllah, brother. May Allah bless you, brother. MashaAllah. Welcome to the brother. How are you feeling?
I'm feeling good.
Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. Give them a hug, brothers.
Dan itu tadi bagaimana teman-teman kalian bisa mendapatkan hikmahnya ya. Memang kita itu disunahkan, kita itu diwajibkan untuk berdakwah walaupun satu ayat ya. Baliru ani walau ayat. Ya, walaupun hanya satu ayat kita diwajibkan untuk berdakwah. Tapi tentu saja kita berdakwah tidak hanya melalui ayat, kita juga bisa berdakwah melalui akhlak juga. Dan itu adalah beberapa hal yang bisa kita renungi dari video tadi. Banyak orang yang kita memang sudah misalnya memberikan penjelasan yang sejelas-jelasnya, namun memang hidayah itu adalah hak prerogatif dari Allah ya teman-teman. Hidayah itu adalah hak yang kita tuh gak bisa ngapa-ngapain kecuali Allah mau untuk menurunkan hidayahnya. Ya misalnya nih, kita udah ngedabrus nih, kita udah kecicicuit sama orang sampai berbusa-busa, kalau Allah belum membukakan pintu hidayahnya, belum melunakkan hatinya, ya kita gak bisa apa-apa. Dia tidak akan pernah masuk Islam kecuali Allah kemudian memberikan hidayahnya karena lewat dakwah kita, tentu karena Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nah itu baru bisa teman-teman. Tapi kadang-kadang orang tuh gak sadar kalau dia itu sebenarnya ketika mencari Islam, dia tuh sudah siap untuk menjemput hidayah. Tapi sekali lagi, bahwa hidayah adalah prerogatif dari Allah, dan hanya Allah lah yang tahu kapan dia akan bersyahadat. Dan semoga saja dia mau bersyahadat secepatnya, karena insya Allah dengan masuk Islam kehidupannya akan menjadi lebih tenang, batinnya tidak akan bergulak kembali seperti itu. Terima kasih teman-teman telah menonton video ini hingga akhir. Sampai jumpa pada video dakwah berikutnya. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.